Okay, let's see what happens. Says that we're ready. Hey, Sue, how you doing? Wow, my picture is backwards. How the heck did that happen? Hey, Victoria Colors and Vicky and Pickle. Hi, guys. Hey, Pickle. Do you guys hear me okay? Awesome. Thank you, Victoria Colors. Oh, thank you, Vicky. I appreciate that a whole bunch. Yeah, thanks, Pickle. Joe Beth is doing moderately well today. Thank you, Sue. How are you? Oh, yeah, Vicky, I bet it is late for you. Holy crap. I mean, holy smoke. Can we say crap? I don't know. Y'all hear me? Yeah. Hey. Okay. Well, there's a few people here today. So first of all, I want to say that my picture is reversed for some reason. And Pat had that reason, had that problem before. And I don't know how to fix it. I tried to do what she described to do, and I don't know where to start. So I'm just going to have to work on that when I'm not on stream. But anyway, so what I wanted to do, I'm sorry to hear that, Sue. That sucks. I know about pain, believe me. I hope you feel better soon. Jeez. Okay. What I wanted to do is just go through a couple of announcements because I have excitement over here on my end of the woods. First of all, I have a regular schedule now. It's Tuesdays, 2 to 4 Pacific, and Sundays, 2 to 4 Pacific. And I'm horrible with time zones, so I don't know what that is in any time zone except for mine. And Central, I guess, is an hour forward ahead. Anyway, but here in Arizona, it is 2 to 4 and on Tuesdays and 2 to 4 on Sundays. And today we've got coloring, but I wanted to make that one announcement and then a couple other things. The picture I'm going to be doing for the Victorian Streamathon, I picked a picture that's steampunkish, and that is this one. This is from Zan Von Zed, who is one of the artists in the new Creative Heaven 2020 calendar. This isn't the picture, of course, because those pictures in the 2020 calendar, if you've seen Coloring with Claire's video review of it, she goes through the whole thing and says that each one of those pictures was exclusively designed and rendered and put into the calendar as an exclusive. So they won't be found anywhere else, which is another really good reason to buy the calendar. But I don't know if I'm going to be doing that. Much as I would like to. But anyway, so this is the picture I'm going to be starting with for the Victorian Colorathon because I thought it was kind of steampunkish, but it's also very simple. And it is possible that, sorry, that was my phone. It is possible that we can finish this within that one stream. So if you guys have any suggestions, background, you want to do your own background. I totally hope you do. And who's that? Hi, Nick and Dina. Thank you for being here. Sorry if I bumped the camera. It's like right by my head because I don't have a whole lot of room, but I'm going to do this anyway. So anyway, this is from Zan Von Zed's Etsy store, and you can get this as a PDF, which is why I picked it for the Victorian Colorathon, because you can grab it from there and you don't have to buy it. I don't think you have to buy a whole coloring book. You might have to buy a PDF bundle, but they're not that expensive and they are an immediate download. So if you end up, mourning of the Victorian Colorathon, oh my God, I want to go to Joe Beth's live stream colorathon for the Victorian colorathon, and I don't have my picture. You can order it and you can have it there with you within how many ever, 30 seconds, a minute and a half, something like that. So anyway, so there's that. And then if we need a second one, I thought I'd do this one from Christine Karen's Characters Line Art Coloring Book. And it's the Queen of Hearts. And it's a very Victorian, but it's also kind of creepy, which is so up my alley because she's got this heart and a little knife through it. So if you want to do that, you can get this book. I think you can find this in her Etsy store and also on Amazon. So whichever way you want to go with that, you might actually be able to find that particular picture. Let me show you again. I've got it marked and I still can't find it. as a single PDF, I'm not sure. I haven't sifted through all of her stuff on the Etsy store yet. Because there's just so little time and so many things to do in a day. Anyway, so that's the second choice. Again, simple, not a real big background, something you can draw your own background in if you want to. I'm going to go over the colors that I use, and I will probably use Prismacolors. I'm definitely going to use Prismacolors for this one. Okay, so when I call out colors, you guys can go through and you can pick your colors if you want to do it pretty much the same as mine, or you can, or we can wait and, you know, we can figure out what I'm going to do with this one. I'm not going to use markers because I really am not proficient with markers, but I may do details in gel pens and stuff like that. Who knows though? It could be, this paper doesn't look to be too thick, so it won't be watercolor. It'll be colored pencils, but it could be, who knows? Who knows what? So anyway, that's a couple of announcements right there. And for the Spooktober-a-thon color along, which is something else that I'm just really going to enjoy. I've got two choices here, both from Beauty of Horror. First one that I thought would be this one. That's number one. And then the second one is this one. Cemetery, it's like, I don't know if anybody's a Monty Python fan, but the whole cart with the carnage in it kind of reminds me of the whole bring out your dead thing. So that's kind of why I picked it. And also because the plague mask, I have a kind of a thing for masks. I love masks. And I made them and collected some. So maybe that's something we can do for a tutorial. Hi, Bev. How you doing? Sue, are you asking me what time it is here? Or are you asking Bev? Oh, okay. So I picked this one because of those things. I also collect bones, and maybe someday we can go. Okay, Sue, sorry about that. I can't scroll. If I want to scroll back through the chat, I got to reach across my viewing pad here. So anyway, so that's my second choice. So we've got number one with the little kid skeletons. Number two with the plague mask. So if you guys have a choice, if you plan on being here for the Spooktober colorathon, throw me a choice and I'll do something about that. Bev says number one. Yeah, they are kind of cute, huh? Okay, got Bev, got Victoria. That's two votes for number one. And if I don't see it, you guys, and you're saying something to me, please put it in capital letters so I can see it, so I know that it's for me. And then I can answer you as soon as possible. If I don't see it the first time, throw it at me again, and I'll do what I can to keep looking up there at chat and seeing what you're doing. Okay? All righty. So, oops. Okay, so there's those. And for today, thought we'd color this one. Now, it doesn't help if it's upside down and backwards, does it? This is another Zan von Zed. And he's got, I'm not sure if it's a he or she. They've got these packs, PDF packages. Ladies of Leisure. And they're really cool. There's a whole bunch of different themes. And I don't think this one came from that. I think this one was just a standalone PDF. And I've had it for so long, I've forgotten. So I apologize. But you can find it in the Etsy store. And I wanted to pick this one because it's got a lot of skin on it. And it's got a castle. And I love doing both. And I also like it that there's no lines in the hair. So there's not a whole lot of interference for what you want to do. You know, as far as I'm concerned, for me, I would rather not have a bunch of lines there so I can just create my own little wave pattern. So, and I tend to do eyes last. So I'll do the eyes last. So, you know, my little screen thingy is kind of off here. Hold on a second. Let me see if I can get this wider so I can see what you guys are just saying here. Couldn't see half of sentences. There we go. Okay, so one other announcement is in October, there is always an event called Inktober. And hold a second, I got to get a drink of water. Oh, that's much better. Oh, my goodness. So I'm going to be participating in the Inktober, and all that is I'm going to do one ink drawing or creation every day through the whole month of October. And I've already got a list of prompts, and the prompts include things like, let me see if I can find it. I got it marked in my little book, and this book is totally awesome. It's a Creative Companion 2019 Organizer and Coloring Art Journal from Ruby Charm Colors. And there's month by month. It's like a date book. It's like a, you know, you can write down everything. I didn't get it until halfway through the year. That's why February is blank. But I also was really in no condition to start saving stuff. My coloring book list. Let's see. Inktober prompts. Here we go. So we've got all kinds of, can you read backwards? Sorry. So we've got all kinds of ring, overgrown, dark, tasty, which I have no clue, but thank God it's on the 25th, right? Got time to think about that one. And each day I'm supposed to draw a picture that based on that prompt. So I'm not going to go like live stream for that kind of thing unless we're in a live stream and somebody requests that I do that, and I haven't done it already, but I will be putting them on my Instagram account, and I may not be doing it every day, but I will catch up and make sure that all of the 31 ink drawings are included in Inktober. So keep your eyes open for that. And if you don't have my Instagram, on my YouTube homepage, up inside that top picture, there are a whole bunch of little, there's like five little icons. One of them is my blog. One of them is my Facebook. One of them is my Instagram. So, and one of them is my website. So go up there and click on the little Instagram icon, and that'll take you to my Instagram account. You can follow me that way, and you can see my Inktober stuff and everything else if you're interested in that. So another thing that this book has is little swatch charts. So I've got Polychromos, and these are my favorites right now. Well, God, hard to say. One of my favorites, the Prismacolors. And they're open stock, like in the Hobby Lobby and Michaels, that are less than, I don't know, half an hour away from here. So if I really, really have a colored pencil emergency, I can go, oh no, I need sage green, and run out to the store. But that probably won't happen because I don't let myself run out. But anyway, so it's got all kinds of swatch charts and stuff. And then in further back, it's got what's really cool is water-based, and then it's got black pages. So if you have like metallics or other colors that will go on black pages, you can just title this yourself, and you can put your black stuff that goes on black pages right there. Oh, cool. It's not backwards for you. Awesome. Victoria Colors. Thank you. I'm so glad to see you. That makes me happy. Okay. So don't forget, my permanent streaming schedule, health permitting, is Tuesdays and Sundays from 2 to 4 p.m. my time Pacific. Yeah, so there's that. One other thing I wanted to show you guys, look at what my husband made. Oh, a couple things, actually. My husband just made this. He dyed the leather, and he put this little cool stamp on it, and he stitched it by hand. He punched all the holes, and I'm like, oh my God, look at that. That, if you had a pocket watch for your steampunk outfit for Ren Faire or for any other thingy, like costume wise, especially since Halloween is coming up, it's a little belt pouch. How cool is that? And he was just experimenting. The guy's really creative when it comes to leather. I don't know. I can make little journals and stuff, but, and pouches for like wood burn runes and stuff like that. But he just goes all out and makes this stuff. He also made another one of these little guys. And I posted pictures of these, but I haven't shown, I don't think I've shown it on video, but there's little glass vials, and these aren't really super great. I mean, they're thin, but, and the corks are more decorative than anything, but for a costume, holy crap, that's really neat, isn't it? And he just sits down and I'll hear him pounding back in the back room, hammering, you know, holes in the leather to put the rivets in. And, oh, he has Laura. Hi, Laura. You snuck in. You sneak you. It's good to see you here. Thank you, Laura, for showing up. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Yes, this one he just finished, I think, yesterday. So there was another one. I think this is the third one that he's made. But yeah, it goes on a belt. And they're so cool. I'm going to be putting them in my store, in my online store. And like I said, there's a link for it at the top of my YouTube page. So those are really neat. And then another thing I wanted to show you is I'm going to be doing this pretty much every time I live stream. These are some of the sun catcher pendulums that I made. And they're beaded. This one is made with a crystal. There we go. A crystal point and gold accents. And then thank you, Laura. I appreciate the thumbs up. Thank you. Thank you so much. What these are, what I've designed these to do is you've got a little loop here and an extra long. You can use it as a pendulum so it swings freely, but you also can pull it through. You can hang that around your rearview mirror. See, it just kind of slips through. You can hang that on your rearview mirror. You can put it on a doorknob. You can put it against a window. You can hang it around a curtain rod in a window, and it'll catch the light. So pretty much all of them that I make have that loop in them. And these are all hand beaded. I just love making these. They're so cool. And I've got tons and tons of different beads. Like, look at this one. I love the red. And then the nice little crystal. And they run around $20. But there's a couple that are a little more expensive. Like I've got one with a 24 faceted cone shaped crystal that's really, really big. And that one's a little more, but let's see. So this one will go through too. Every almost all of them in the loop will go through like that, I think. So, but yeah. So you've got a little loop. Kind of neat. And those are the seed beads and crystal. And then this one's made out of a semi-precious stone called sodalite, which is, it has calming qualities. Is it sodalite or is this lapis? Sometimes it's hard to tell. Lapis has pyrite in it. So if I can find a glint of gold, it's lapis. It's lapis lazuli. So it's got the silver, I don't know if you can see that, little silver accent thingies on it. I love the little cones. They're really neato. Anyway, yeah, so I make these. These are all in my online store. And you know I got to shamelessly plug that, right? Okay, so why don't we go ahead and get started? I'm going to lift this up because otherwise it'll make a line in my picture. I don't want to do that. So that's just a little piece that came with this cutting mat, which I love because you can use it also as a palette for ink tints and for watercolor pencils. Also for markers, say you want to use a marker, like a water-based marker, you can just like write, you can draw, you know, put your ink down, and then you can use a brush to pick that up and put it on your picture so you can control how much color pigment is actually going onto your paper. It's really cool. Sometimes when you have those brush markers, you start going and there's just all kinds of liquid comes out. So, oh, and this is kind of what I did for as practice for Inktober. It's a ink drawing. We live right by the Superstition Mountains. And if you've never seen the Superstition Mountains, I encourage you to Google it because they're something, man. They're huge and they're right. I can see them from my kitchen window. It's just a real quick sketch that I did with my fountain pen. And then I went over it with a water brush. So that's why it's all messy like that. But I figure if I can do that in 3.5 minutes, then I can make something much better in 10 minutes. And Inktober's done. So that's kind of cool. And that paper is really nice too. It's a recycled hemp paper. And I have no guilt using it for whatever. Okay, so what I want to do with this is I'm going to use some distress ink. And I'm going to use some archival ink. And I didn't learn this on my own. I give Zucchini Kitty, Karen, all the credit because I watch her videos all the time. Hey, JoBeth, I got a question for you. I have a bullet casing from my dad's 21-gun salute. Oh, cool. Is there any way to put a crystal in it and make it stay in there? You can crimp it. Victoria Colors, you can crimp it. I caution you there, though, because crystals, of course, are very brittle and it could fracture the crystal. However, if you don't mind gluing it, you could put some E6000 glue in there, which is pliable and remains pliable, yet it's really, really industrial strength. So E6000, you can get them in little tubes. I don't recommend getting the big tubes because inevitably you're going to use some of it and the rest of it you're going to throw away because it dries up. There's no way around it. So I recommend getting like it's like a 4-pack. I wonder if I've got one right here. It's like a, oh, sorry, kids. Didn't mean to take you for a roller coaster ride there. Oh, crap. Hold on. Hold the phone. Okay. So E6000 is a really good product. And yes, I recommend it. I don't have any here. But anyway, so that's about the only things. And then, but first you want to put like a hole in the top. I don't know if you have a drill bit that will go through metal. You can use that. I don't recommend using like a punch or a nail or something primitive like that because you're going to tweak the shell casing. So, yeah. Hey, Leslie. First time catching me live. You're in Australia? Holy moly. Thank you for being here. Thank you. Awesome. Yeah, Laura, E6000 is like best thing since sliced bread, huh? Okay, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to use this for the distress ink because I love this little tool. Oh, Victoria, yeah. You could put holes through the top, you know, before you glue the crystal in, and then you can get a really large jump ring, a circular ring, or you can create a bale from some sturdy wire, something like stainless steel wire that doesn't tarnish, and then, or even red brass, which is really nice and durable. It'll turn colors too, like copper will naturally when it's exposed to the air, but it takes a long time. And then you can use that to put it on the chain. So you can do that. You know, there's probably videos on YouTube about how to do it too, which will go through it visually. I don't know if you're a visual person like I am, but visually always helps me. So I do recommend trying to look up some kind of a video or something. Oh yeah, the fumes, Laura, I know, the fumes from E6000, holy, yeah, they're pretty strong. You're welcome, Victoria. Okay, so I like this tool, but I also like the idea of putting in like mottled colors in the bricks, and that's what I'm gonna use these for. And I've got Hickory Smoke, and I've got Vintage Photo. So the Hickory Smoke is archival. And I don't know if you guys have seen Zucchini Kitty's videos where she went through what the difference is between archival and distress ink, and there's a big difference. The archival ink, it's not like a water-based color at all. It won't move once you put it on the paper. Like, you can move distress ink because it's like almost like a watercolor. So you can kind of move it. You can reactivate it a little bit. This one, the archival ink, you cannot. So I thought it would be kind of cool to start with the archival ink and make some little models, some little dots and shades and stuff with that, and then go over the whole castle with the distress ink in the vintage photo color. And then I'd have like this two-tone kind of thing going on. Oh my gosh, Victoria, no, this doesn't smell half as bad as acetone. So, yeah. Hey, Connie. Hi. It is good to see you here. Wow. Thank you, guys. So cool. Okay. So we've got, oh, and just so the new guys coming in, new people coming in, if you want to know, this is what we're coloring today. It's from Zan Von Zed on Etsy. Zan Von Zed is one of the artists that is in the upcoming Creative Heaven 2020 calendar. You won't find that picture in the calendar in their Etsy store because it's an exclusive to the calendar. But there's tons and tons of stuff. And I wanted to color something with a lot of skin tone in it because I love doing skin tone. But so what we're going to do, what I'm going to do is I'm going to start with also one of the details on this picture is, you see this part down here? This is really cool. It's like a cutaway of the moat. And I don't know if you can see, there's like little fishies swimming in it. So it's almost like it's been placed in this clear bowl, and you can see into the bowl where all the fishes are swimming around. It's really kind of neat. And, you know, whimsical and stuff. So anyway, what I'm going to do is, this is craft foam, and it's, you can find this craft foam at Walmart and Michael's and Hobby Lobby. I think Walmart just has packages because I haven't really looked for single sheets, but I'm pretty sure that Hobby Lobby or Michael's or another craft store might have single sheets. But what I wanted to do, I can't throw that around. What I wanted to do was use this little craft foam to make like shadows and lines. Instead of doing whole round with this, I'm going to use a more directional approach and use this. I'm going to wipe off a lot of it on there, wipe off some of it on there, and then I'm just going to and I'm going to kind of have my light coming in from over here. So that's how I'm going to shade. And the reason why I wanted it to come in from like over here is because I've already got shadow on her here. That's because of her hair. But this way I can decide, you know, she's got shadow here. So it kind of makes sense to me. But I can go. And it doesn't matter if I get it outside the castle because this is all going to be filled in. I'm going to do the sky in blue. So I'm just going to go through here. And I've never done this before on this size, this scale. Usually what I do is when I'm using this foam, I just use it little tiny bits on. I make these little envelopes for scrapbooks because I have, probably 100 pounds of miscellaneous paper, probably more than that, laying around that I got for free, except for a couple hundred pieces of scrapbook paper that I found at the thrift store for a total of like $12. So, I had it forever, but so I'm just going to go through here and kind of where I want it darker, I'm just going to make a little darker shapes. Don't really want a triangle though. Let's just do a little dot. There we go. You don't have to really push too hard. but you kind of want to pay attention to, you know, where you're putting stuff, because you want your shadows to make sense. So we've got that. Is anybody else coloring anything? Put it in chat. Tell me what you're coloring. I'm interested. Everybody's always coloring something cool. Yeah. Still working. I'm sorry, Laura. I know. You know what? I went a whole year when I was really sick from chemo and radiation treatments. I went a whole year without doing anything creative. And I started watching this guy on Instagram. His name's Alan Williams. He's a superb artist. He's done artwork for like Hellboy and Pan's Labyrinth and stuff like that. And he does these Instagram 1 hour bits every, when he can on Saturday nights, if he's not at a convention. And his whole philosophy is, I don't want to hear, you know, I don't want to hear you say, I don't have time for art. Oh, cool. Nick and Tina, you're coloring dragons. Sweet. You know, I think we should do a color along thing where we color, everybody colors a dragon. I've been thinking about that because I love dragons and I love coloring them, but I've got like tons and tons of stuff that I want to color other stuff. And I love doing portraits and skin, so I kind of lean that way. Yeah, Laura, I know. But so I was watching this guy, Alan Williams, and he's like, he's always like ending his live stream with just 15 minutes, just draw something. So I made a deal with myself and I said, I'm going to devote 15 minutes a day to drawing something. I'm going to pick up that pencil and I'm going to do something. And oh my God, it worked. And I started going, it was like 15 minutes at first. I was just like, oh man, do I got to do this? But I wasn't doing anything else. It's so much frame of mind for me. So it was kind of difficult to get started. Yeah, Leslie, no kidding. Hi, Leslie. I don't think I said hi to you yet. And I didn't see you come in, I don't think. But hello, and thank you for being here. It's awesome. So, yeah, you know, I was just like, wow, this sucks. But it was like, I told myself that I had to do that, right? So, and then after a while, I was going 20 minutes and then I was an hour and a half and I was like, where'd the time go? And then, you know, you look down at your paper and you go, whoa, look what I did. Oh my God, I feel so good now. And it totally flipped my frame of mind because I wasn't just creating something. I was doing something that I love to do. So yeah, you know, I mean, I told him in the stream one night, I was like, you kind of saved my life because I was going totally bonkers sitting in this house with nothing to do. And here I am. And one of the things that I colored was I had some photographs of some datura. It's a poisonous plant. It's absolutely beautiful. And it's got white blooms that are like this huge. And some of them bloom at night and some of them bloom in the daytime, but it's a desert flower and it's deadly poisonous in high doses, but it's also a hallucinogen and it was a holy plant with shaman. So it intrigued me because the history of the plant is like really, really interesting. Victoria is working on a work in progress in fairy tales. Cool. Excellent. See, that's something else. I haven't colored a fairy yet. Well, I kind of have. I did the Laura Rafferty, Laura's fake horn from her circle portraits. That was a blast, man. That was fun. So anywho, I took that photograph and I drew it. Well, you don't realize how intricate flowers are until you start drawing them like, you know, real time. Even ink drawings where you're doing just basic outlines and shadows and stuff, those are pretty intricate too. Boy, if I could talk and have it made. And you don't really realize it until you start working on one and you're like, wow, look at all those little tiny shadows. What the heck? I didn't see that when I started. Whose idea was this anyway? So, you know, so I drew this flower and it's on my Instagram. If you want to see it, it's of course in graphite. So it's a black and white and it's only like 5x7, but I'm really proud of it. It after that long, not drawing too much. And then all of a sudden I'm drawing, you know, this flower that came out so well. I'm just like happy. So yeah. Oh yeah. Laura. I know she is a fairy. It's the whole unicorn horn thing kind of threw me. I'm just kidding. Okay. So I'm going to move on to the brown and I'm not super good at this yet, but I understand the concept. Yeah, that's good. And it doesn't matter if I get it all over, like inside where the trees are and stuff like that. Like these trees right here that are growing against the wall. There's like, they look like little junipers. Because I'm just going to go over that with colored pencil. And if they have a brown base, it's just, I mean, juniper on the inside, they're wood. So the brown may not come through like blatantly, but it's there. It can be there. No problem. And now I'm going to go over the castle wall with a little bit of pencil later and kind of fill in some shadows and stuff because I'm kind of a perfectionist like that. And we may not finish this on stream, but hey, you know what? I'm having fun and I hope you are. I hope everybody's doing something interesting. I hope everyone's healthy-ish at least. Okay, so that side's done. I'm going to flip my picture around because that's what I do. I'm always flipping my picture around because really, I think that it's way more important that your hand is comfortable than you're stretching and bending in unnatural ways because you're just asking for trouble. So I recommend moving your paper. Hey, this is really neat. I like this. And if I want to, I can always add some gray. Now see the gray, the just the archival ink, it's not moving. It's not moving at all. And it doesn't matter if it's splotchy because it's a stonework. I mean, stones aren't always smooth colored. Bricks aren't even always all smooth colored. So, you know, you've got natural impurities and stuff. Give them character. A little bit right there. A little bit more ink here. Doot, doot, doot. Oh, yeah. And I got a new light over here. My husband put in a new light for me. Yoo-hoo! Awesome guy. I told him, I don't want to hear you cuss. He's so funny. He cusses, gets mad at stuff and cusses. And then 2 seconds later, he's fine. Okay, almost done with that part. There's a little bit down inside there, inside her hair. And again, I'm just going to dot that. Thank you, Karen. Looks pretty nice. Yep. Okay. Adequate. Okay. Now, hey, Jo Beth, I'm doing color long next. Beautiful. Oh, sweet. So, Nick, your stream starts at 4? Thank you, Connie. Hey, you should totally do it. It's really neat. It doesn't cost a whole lot either. And you don't have to use one of these thingies, but I mean, they're really super convenient. You probably make one, but I didn't want to. Okay, so that's kind of done. Let's see. I feel like I missed something. Did I miss something? I'm going to check chat earlier if I can find my... Oh, yeah. There's my pointy. Oh, I got everything. Okay. So, okay, where do we want to go now? I think I'll do some more on the wall. And I'm using Prismacolors again. So I'm going to do a light on the bricks. This is that's a warm gray. Don't want a warm gray. I want a cool gray. That'll work. Look at my tiny little pencil. I know it's not as tiny as others, but... And I'm just going to go over really, really, really light. Just to get rid of all the white spots and stuff. And I'm going in tiny circles on some of this because it gives a smoother coverage. Although it's not going to look really smooth anyway because the artist lines, and I may emphasize that later, go like this. So it kind of looks like a dome. And then we've got this down here, which I'll darken that up with something else. See, all the brown is just kind of disappearing inside underneath the gray. So there's that. Not sure I like these. These are manicured trees. They're like round balls. They kind of remind me of the suckers in Candyland, the Candyland game. Uh-oh. Why did I not put this back? So, Nick, do you mean that in the stream that you're doing today, you're going to be doing a Beauty of Horror picture? And I may go darker on these. I don't know. It depends on how it looks when I get closer to being done. Not bad. And then there's all these little tiny windows. See those little bitty windows? Those should probably all be facing or shadowed in. I just get the impression that this is in, you know, daylight. So probably we're not going to see any glow coming out of them. If I wanted to, I could do the whole picture at nighttime. And then the night would... Oh, you know what? French gray would look really good in there. So we're going to get this one. This is French gray, 70%. Yeah, that's good. That's cool. It's cool. Mm-hmm. Uh-oh. Message retracted. Why did you retract your message? Okay, hey, JoBeth. All next month? Sweet. I'm excited. Those are fun. Glad I found them. I was looking at them from before and because I like creepy stuff. And I saw those and I was just like, no way. Because a lot of people do the fairies and, you know, dragons and... While I love fairies and dragons and princesses and things like that, I also love creepy. Oh, Leslie. Oh, my gosh. Inks are fun. It's just experimentation is fun. And that's kind of the deal, you know? I mean, for me anyway, oh my gosh, you should watch Dee Dee. Nick, what do I got to do to join? Do you want me to, I mean, am I going to be coloring something on live stream? Because I can do that. I can do creepy almost every day. In fact, I've got some pictures that I did that qualify as creepy enough to be. And I can't find them, wouldn't you know it? Yeah, it's okay. That qualified it enough to be Halloweenish. Oh, Sue. Oh my gosh. Art has been a part of my life since I was a little kid. I've always had art around me. My mother was an artist. She was a brilliant oil painter. And she never thought she was good enough, which is a shame because pretty sure that if she had put herself out there and risked the rejection, she probably could have been very successful just oil painting. And she just didn't have a thick enough skin to do that. And my stepdad kept telling her, you know, put your stuff out there, you know? And she's just, no, it's okay. So anyway, I wish she had. Okay, another thing you're going to find out about me is I jump around all the time. Is Laura still there? And yes, Nick, I would love to join. That would be great because I think it would be fun. Man, talking makes you thirsty. Woo! Okay, so I think I'm going to start the skin because I just can't help it. So I'm going to use Laura's guidelines. Oh, absolutely, Sue. Absolutely. Okay, so now she's got like a line here. I don't know what that's all about, but I'm not really going to pay attention to that. I think I'm just going to start with, and this is Sienna Brown. And my Prismacolor number is not, oh, there it is. It's 945, PC 945 Sienna Brown. And these are Laura's guideline colors. Thank you, Laura, because you're awesome and a genius and super talented. I don't know if you're still here or not. I must have missed you if you left. I missed you leaving. And I don't want to go too dark here because there's going to be a reflection coming off of her here. Yes, it's fabric, but if you look here, how this is, there's going to be a reflection coming off of her skin from this side. So I don't really want to go too dark there. Just enough to give it the illusion that there's some kind of shadow there because that'll help make it look round. So I'm just going to go real light. And she's going to get a medium skin tone. I just see her with a medium skin tone. And one of the things that I like to do is I like to modify the eyes. So I may make them like a little more, I don't know, different than that. So, yeah, but I'm going to do some shadowing. And this is just the first layer. Lots and lots of layers. A little bit of shadowing here. And there's going to be a little shadowing like right here. And because it's blue, because the sky is blue, it's daytime, there's a lot of ambient blue light flying around. It's going to be Oh, take care, Connie. Bye. Sleep well. Sweet dreams. Hey, May. Good to see you. Sue, she does look sultry. I know. But look at her outfit. It's like her middle name right now, you know? So because there's so much blue ambient light flying around, a lot of things are going to have, the shadows are going to be like bluish. So that comes later though. We're just going to do this first layer. And you can do it the other way around. You can start with blue, but I wouldn't recommend it because blue is such a dark color and it's really easy to get it too dark. So you probably don't want to start with blue, but, you know, I mean, people do it. It just depends. It's there's no wrong way. You want to make her look blue, make her look blue. In fact, there's a, I don't know if you guys are familiar with Lisa Matrokin. She's on Facebook. She's took a poll on her Facebook page and asked everybody if they wanted to have a tutorial. And one of the choices was to make a regular picture, like, you know, run-of-the-mill fist picture, maybe look like a dead zombie person. I think it's a whole, you know, Halloween themed thing. But I thought, well, that's a great idea. You know, that would be really fun if you're into that. Personally, I think it would be fun. Yeah. So who do we got? Hey, wife, Nick and May. Above question. Not me. Don't forget to put questions for me in caps because, like, I'm looking up there and looking at questions and I still don't know if they're for me or not. This is my first official live stream in color. So color and chat. So thank you guys for being here because super cool. And wow, my voice changed. Ah, just kidding. Oh yes, she does, Leslie. Oh my God. Yep. Yep, Lisa Matrokin, she's got the whole dramatic, creepy theme stuff down really well. And it's fun, too. And she's such a brilliant artist. I mean, different. Well, all artists are unique, but I really like, I guess I just like her stuff because it's creepy. So, yeah, you know. Let's go a little bit. Still using the Sienna Brown PC945 with a sharp point and a light touch. Very light. My husband thinks he's got to be really, really quiet. He's so funny. Mia. Hi, Mia. Welcome. Thank you for coming in. Sweet. Woohoo. Oh, wrong side. I'll fix that later. Actually, I'll fix it right now. I use the same eraser that a lot of other people use. It's a Tombow Mono Zero white eraser, and it's super, super, duper, super tiny. You guys see that? Let's see. Okay, that's probably good enough. Anyway, it works really well. I absolutely love Tombow products. I haven't met a bad one yet. In fact, when I use graphite, I use Tombow Mono 106B pencils. And they are like drawing with black velvet. They're super, super cool. You've got to be careful with them, though, because they're very, very dark. And the graphite doesn't erase really easily if you go too hard. And the whole idea behind using those is same as with colored pencil, layer, 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 layer. And every layer is, Bye, Mia. Oh, no, to the doctor. Oh, I hope you're okay. Holy moly. So many people going to the doctor or being sick. And I'm going to go a little bit darker right here so I get a darker undertone when I go in with my final shadows. That's like her neck, this little tiny triangle right there. Can everybody see okay? I know it's kind of far away, and I don't know if I can zoom this. I was looking for a zoom and I couldn't find one, so I'm sorry. But if you need me to, I can always lift up the picture. I can lift up the page if you guys want to see a detail. So let me know. And I don't know if you can see this, but her outfit, all this up here, all this looks like little jewels. And it looks like it's got like jewels sewn on all the way down, which is another reason I wanted to do it, because you know you can use glitter on that. Okay, Leslie, thank you. And May, thank you. And Sue, thank you too. Okay, so here we go. I almost can't see. Lights are so bright. Makes it warm in here, man. Woo! I don't want to turn a fan on because the fans we have are really loud. There's one in the hallway right now that keeps me cooler at night, but it's loud. So I'm going to leave this shadow alone. I'm not going to color over that one because, again, the light's coming in like this. But I am going to shadow over here just a little bit and under here. Just a little bit under her chin, lip right here. Round. There's really not a whole lot, you know? It looks like there's a whole bunch of skin showing, but you've got cat here. Yes, I have a cat. I have a cat and a dog. You might hear the cat come in because she's got a really big mouth. She's so vocal. And she doesn't know I'm on a computer right now. She probably thinks, Pat! How you doing, lady? Good to see you. Hugs. And flowers, too. I know, I'm not getting a whole lot of notifications either. It's kind of frustrating. I just have to keep checking and checking. It's weird because I won't get a notification and then I'll go and I'll look at my phone to see if I've gotten any emails. And all of a sudden, all these notifications pop up. Like earlier today, I had 4 pop up when I went to check my email. And I was like, wow, thanks a lot. Now, who have I missed? But anyway. Yeah. That bites the big one, doesn't it? Okay. A little bit of shade here. A little bit of shade. I think I can make that a little darker inside that suggestion. Artist's suggestion. She's so pretty. I think I'm going to make this arm a little darker because it is actually being, if our sun is coming in from over here, that whole side of her body is going to be darker. So we've got highlights on the back of her arm, here. Like I said, I'm leaving that alone, but we've got highlights all along here. That's going to be more highlighted. And probably this is going to be lighter, but it'll be shading. Yeah, that was brilliant. this is going to be more shaded in here because the front panel here is kind of over her, So it's blocking some of the ambient light. It kind of reminds me, I used to belly dance. And yes, I used to belly dance. I know, hard to imagine. I made these, they're called panel skirts, and you're basically supposed to wear them over another skirt or over a pair of harem pants. And I used to love making them because it was basically just two pieces of fabric on a drawstring. But then I could add like tassels and bells and coins and pendants and all kinds of little ephemera that I had laying around. I mean, charms and whatever. And I would sell them online. But that's what this reminds me of. It reminds me of one of those panel skirts. Oh, belly dancing is, it was challenging. It was really fun, but it was challenging. A friend of mine was teaching the classes, and she was doing American tribal style. And that was, she wanted us all to do the whole neck thing. It's like a head bob thing where you move your head sideways, and it looks really cool when you do it right. And I just could never get it to look right. I'd stand in front of the mirror and I'd practice, and I couldn't get it to look right. Turns out I have, my neck is screwed up, and it has been for a really long time. In fact, if you can see my, and right now you can because I don't weigh very much, my vertebrae in my neck, one or two of them is actually out of line, and it's been that way for way longer than I realized it. So when I was trying to do the whole head bobby neck thing in belly dance class, the reason why I couldn't do it is because it wasn't physically possible for me. I just didn't know it. So I'd try it. And I kept telling my teacher, Justine, I can't make myself do that. And she's like, well, wing it. Cause she was like that. She was cool like that. But yeah. And that woman, oh my God, she was so cool. I don't know if you guys have ever seen the sword dance where the dance, the belly dancer dances with the sword balanced on their head. She had an actual sharpened sword that she would use. And she said that during her practice, one time it fell off her head and cut her toe. And I was like, dude, oh, anyway, she did the, at one of our art shows for Northland Pioneer College, when I went to that college, that's in Sholo, by the way, Sholo, Arizona. She did the whole routine and it was magical. Oh my God, that woman's talented. But she did the whole sword dance, and she, of course, did not drop the sword, but she did the whole, she got down, she was dancing, she got down on her knees, and she did the backward bend, and then got back up again, no hitches. That woman was just like, I was like, whoa! So, anyway, that was really cool. I was happy to be there for that. You hurt somebody if you belly danced? No, Sue, you know what? The more there is, as people seem to like it. I don't know if you know, if you've seen any belly dance troops. We have one here, a couple here in Arizona, one that goes to the Renaissance Fair every year called, I can't remember, Gaza Baladi or something like that. And there are a couple of heavier girls in there, and they're just as graceful and beautiful as the skinny ones. It's just, it's, I don't know, man, you move the right way and you train the right way and it doesn't matter anymore. So yeah. In fact, it in some places that's a sign of abundance, you know, ethnic stuff. Oh, there's Jack. There's my puppy dog. He's a little Jack Russell Terrier. He's way over there. He probably won't come in. He's going deaf, and we think he's going blind, and he's like almost 14. He's really old. But I've had him since he was 6 weeks old. Had him since he was a little baby. Yeah, Pat, I know, shaking my head. A belly? Yeah, well, that's true. Least an abdomen, right? May, I'm sorry. Oops, almost forgot the side of her arm. What am I doing? What am I thinking? Oh, and I did finish my picture of the photograph that I took and turned into grayscale. I just haven't posted it on Instagram yet because I wasn't happy with the pictures I was taking of it, and time got away from me, and here I am. I'm coloring. Dang it. Back away from the colored pencils and no one gets hurt. Yeah, Jack. He's a sweetie. He's senile. I swear he is. It's like he's got doggy Alzheimer's or something, and I don't mean that as a joke. I really am serious. He seems to not be really aware anymore, which is a little disturbing, but hey, it happens, right? Sorry, I hope you guys didn't hear that. My phone just vibrated. Oh, you want to see it? I think it's done anyway. There we go. The colors are kind of washed out on this camera, but the photograph will come out better. Yeah, you can't really see the colors very well. I had to bring up the photograph to get the up here in this corner, because in the photograph this is like, or in the grayscale this was like all black, and I couldn't pick out the details. But yeah, well, thank you, Pat. It was super fun, but very challenging because those leaves, oh my God, look at all those leaves. Holy moly. What did I get myself into? Yeah. Yeah, when dogs get old, they can't tell you, oh, I can't hear you very well. And you end up yelling and getting frustrated. And thank you, Sue. Okay, well, I think that's good for the first layer. So we're going to move on to burnt ochre. That's it. And I'm gonna go over the colors that I've already put in, and I'm gonna extend it out just a little. So I'm gonna start at the top. I'll probably jump around all over the place, but start at the top. Really light hand. I'm gonna move in circles mostly. And I don't always adhere to my own rules because they're really not rules. It's like guidelines mostly. Yes, I'm a pirate. Type of, yeah, geek. Oh, Pirates of the Caribbean, whatever, that kind of thing. We're both, my husband and I are both Rennies, so anything that has to do with anything that has to do with the Renaissance fair, we're just like, yay! In fact, we make our own costumes. I made a I converted one of those, the Mardi Gras masks with the really long nose. It looks like kind of like a raven. I found one at this little store called Big Lots. It's kind of like a bargain store where everything's marked down, sort of like Tuesday Morning Pat. And I picked it up for like $3 because I was like, oh, that's perfect. It's a perfect base. I'm gonna paint it. And I ended up making this really elaborate, cool raven mask out of it. And the coolest thing about it is I can get dressed up in costume and I can go to the Renaissance Fair with that mask on. And oh, and what I did was for the eyes, I glued a pair of sunglasses on the inside of the mask. These big, like, Jewish lady sunglasses that I got. When you wear a mask like that and you're all dressed up in a costume at our Renaissance Fair here in Arizona, you can do whatever you want. I mean, people think that my husband and I are part of the show because we're so good at going out there and participating in the show. So we just go out and he's got armor and chainmail and leather armor and he made, by the way. And we just go and we have a lot of fun and people want our picture all the time, which is cool too, because they can't see my face. They don't know, you know, they can post that anywhere because my face isn't showing, which I really love. And it's very convenient. I don't have to say, hey, can I have your business card? I don't want you to post this blah, 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 or wherever. And, you know, I want a commission or whatever. But it's super fun and the kids love it. Yeah, it's fun. It's a lot of fun. We have a good time. The only problem with the Renaissance Fair is everybody uses, there's like three bathrooms and they're big bathrooms, but you know, halfway through the day, those things start smelling because we have, that's right when we start getting up into the 90s and 100s. And it is not pretty. But there are some years when it stays cool longer. And I wish it would do that more often. But, you know, what's that they say about wishing in one hand? I know I'm bad. At least I didn't swear. So, can't believe today's Tuesday. Feels like it's later in the week. Oh, so Pat, I don't know if you know, if you saw that or not, or saw it or not, or heard it or not, but I've got a permanent schedule. Anybody else that came in after? Who else came in after? All I can see on my chat is Sue and Pat. So my permanent schedule is Tuesdays and Sundays from 2 to 4 p.m. Pacific time. And I apologize, I'm horrible with time zones, so I don't know what that is in like other time zones. All I can say is it's Pacific right now. I'm in Arizona, so whenever that is for you. And I was thinking that maybe, you know, sometimes like there are nights when I can't sleep. And even though I can't make a lot of noise because most of the time, of course, the hubs is sleeping. And if I wake the dog up, the dog wakes him up and then the dog wants to go out because he's old and has a small bladder. But the dog, not the husband. Anyway, yeah, I'm sure you heard that. He's probably standing back there going, dang it. Oh, yeah, Leslie, you're in Australia. You're Wednesday already. Yeah. Yeah, Pat. I'm sorry, I didn't hear that. I think he just said I'm not laughing. Pat, are you asking me? Or
I'm laughing.
Oh. Oh, okay, good. He's laughing. He's a good-natured guy, so he's laughing. Thank God. He knows where I sleep. Get these shadows. Shadows. Just love doing this. You know what? I forgot to do her nose. Shoot. Well, I need to go get my darker pencil again. Her nose is going to have a little bit of a shadow right here. and her forehead too over here. Completely missed that. Wow. Dork. Aw. May will always be here tomorrow. You can always ask her, how's the day? What's the day like? Good, bad. Or you can get one of my pendulums and you can say, is it going to be a good day? Yes or no? And then have the pendulum answer your question. And that's what they're for. Besides making rainbows all around your room. Let's give her a little bit more shade right here. A little bit of a shadow. Round. And the end of a nose is somewhat round. There's like a little ball in there. Hers is rather pointy. But I'm thinking, you know what? I can kind of modify that. And sometimes I'll do that before I color. I'll go in and I'll say, I don't like this line here. And I'll just modify it as best I can. And then as I go over it with layer and layer and layer of pencil, it looks the way closer to the way that I want it to. So it's not impossible, but once you have this kind of a thing printed up, it's a little difficult if it's got like, you know, if the ink smears and stuff like that. Do you guys see that little tiny gnat flying around? No, I'm not dreaming it. Hi, Nick and Tina. You're back. Welcome back. It's okay. You got to do stuff. You go do stuff. Not a problem. It's a pretty tame chat room right now. People ever get that rambunctious boy? Nah. No biggie. You know, I should put this pencil down now because I'm just getting a little bit crazy. And this is a burnt ochre. Burnt ochre 943. Oops. That's my second color. You can see how her shading is coming out. Kind of. It's taking shape. It's coming along. Hungry for dinner already. Pasta and chicken. Stuff with protein and tons of cheese because my doctor told me to gain weight. Sucks only weighing 103 pounds. Ah! You know, I've kind of wanted the same thing, Pat. Does May ever sleep? I bet she watercolors in her dreams. Man, May, you're so dang talented. I love your watercolors. I could just look at those all day. You should have a one-woman show, lady. I want to be like you when I grow up. Seriously, though, you have a talent that totally inspires me. I keep saying that. You're probably going to get sick of hearing it, but it's true. Yeah. You can sleep when you're old. I have to put myself to sleep at night. I take ibuprofen, which I'm very sensitive to. So I take a small dose of ibuprofen. And of course I eat first, but, and I take a couple other things that are really mild that my doctors have prescribed for me, and it puts me out because I'm so sensitive to it. But like if I take NyQuil or something, damn, if you take a good dose of that, it's good. I mean, it'll put you to sleep, whatever. I can only take a half a dose of NyQuil or any other cough medicine because otherwise it's too much and it just makes me high. And then I can't sleep. Makes me hyper. And So I have to really be careful with that kind of stuff. So what color do you guys think her dress should be? We should do her dress in one color and her jewels in another color, like some kind of, I don't know. Yeah, May moved to the States. You know what? I wouldn't ask May to move to the States because she lives in a beautiful part of the world. And yes, there are beautiful parts in the States. In fact, Northern Arizona is absolutely gorgeous up along the Mogollon Rim. Holy crap, that place is gorgeous. But May, I don't know if I'd ever, if I was there, I may never come home. If I went to visit, I keep telling my son that. My son lives in Portland, Oregon. And he keeps saying, Mom, you got to come and visit me. And I can't travel right now. But I keep telling him, Alex, if I come to visit you, I may not come home. So I can't go to visit you and I'm ready to stay. There's a half truth in there because I miss him so much. But yeah, man, Portland, shoo, talk about a gorgeous place. I don't know how far up to go with this. I'm just going to make it really light right there until I decide. This has got to be colored here too, but I don't want it as dark as the rest of it. Like as dark as that. I don't want it that dark. And I like this little shadow here. Yeah, that looks okay. Let's go a little bit further in here. I don't know how, looks kind of splotchy right there because of the back, the undertone of gray. Looks like there's a splotch right there. And I didn't do it. So, do I have votes about what color we want our dress? Oh, not yet. Okay. I don't know. Got time to decide, though. So for Sunday, I was thinking about maybe doing, I have these trees that I like to do. And if you've gone to my website or my Instagram or even my Facebook page, I've got like some of these trees, tree paintings and acrylics that I do of like leafless trees, like they're dead, just like a bunch of tangles of branches and stuff. And what time is it over there right now, Jill Beth? It is 3:30 on the nose, Pat. Holy crap, it's 3:30? Oh man. We only got a half an hour left, guys. See, I knew we wouldn't get done with this, but that's okay because I really enjoy doing it. Anyway, for Sunday, for Tuesdays, I think I'll do this. And then for Sunday, I was thinking about doing a tutorial with acrylic paints and showing you how I do my trees and paintings. So I don't know if you guys are interested in that. You wouldn't need a whole lot of supplies. You would just need like a canvas board or something to paint on, even a canvas, you can get canvas pads where it's not actually on a board. It's just like a piece of paper, but it's canvas. You can get that. And, oh, red. I see. Red. Sounds good to me, Nick and Tina. Okay, Leslie. Thank you. Thank you for being here. I really appreciate it. You take care, okay? So anyway, I was thinking about Sunday, maybe taking you through a tutorial of an acrylic painting of how I do those scraggly trees, because that is another passion of mine, doing scraggly trees. I have some on my bathroom walls. When we moved in, I painted my bathroom walls with those, with my trademark trees. Everyone sees those trees and they went, oh, Jo Beth was here. They go, Jo Beth was here. Yeah, that's it. So anyway, would you guys be interested in something like that? A tutorial of acrylic painting with the trees. And I think it would be really cool because it's kind of spooky looking. Okay. Well, that should be fun. So you'll need a canvas, some kind of something to paint on, a really small brush, a medium brush, and a larger brush. And you will need some a sponge or cotton, like cotton balls, or the kind of cotton that you find in the top of a vitamin bottle that you take out when you get your vitamins. One, a couple of those. Some acrylic paints in blues, grays, blacks, and white. And then your water. That's all you need. And you can use for a palette, you can use anything plastic, because once acrylic paint dries, you can peel it off. Or you can use a paper plate and just throw it away later. I encourage plastic and peel it off, because it leaves less of a footprint, trash for Mother Earth. So some kind of palette. And oh my goodness. Let's see. Okay. I'm getting all kinds of notifications all of a sudden on my phone. I apologize. It's on vibrate, and this is vibrating the table. Oh goodness. So, okay, let's continue here. But it should be fun. I mean, it's not a difficult thing to do, and I would really love to see everyone's interpretation. In fact, if you wanted to do the whole wine and paint thing, go for it, man. Go for it. Or if you want, you know, beer. Am I allowed to say that? Anyway, let's bring this out a little bit. We want to make her look round, especially her thigh. We want her to look round. Thighs should be nice and round. Okay. Now you can see, I don't know if you guys can see it. It's kind of washed out. Holy crap. Oh, that's awful. Okay. Let's see if I can. No, come on, lights. Let's do this. Oh, that looks better anyway. I need a little clamp thing. I'm going to have to fix that. Anywho, here on her thigh and her arm, right here and here, I don't know if you guys can see how that's working, where she's got the light right in the middle. She's got a lighter spot right down the center of her arm, center of her thigh, and on that other arm. And then you can see on her face where she's got the light spots, but she's got the shadow over to the side. Oh, that's even better. Okay, so she's got here, she's got shades here and here. This is partially from the artist, but then there's this shade here. She's got down this, kind of the center of her face, she's got a light spot, and then she's got the light here, here, down her thigh right here. Because the light is ambient, and that's why it's shaded from both sides. It's coming from all over the place. But the basic light is coming from here. When someone's out in, and I don't know if you guys know, if you've ever just sat back and watched or anything, but yes, when the sun is shining from a particular direction, you've got, like, you know, a really good bright light and a dark shadow on the other side. If it's an ambient light, which means that it's coming from all over the place, it's going to leave, you're going to have shadow, but you're not going to have a definite dark, dark directional shadow. For example, when May did the coloring book, I can't remember what coloring book it was in. It was in Flora or something. May, where you did candle the little guy was in the pantry and he was eating stuff and there was a candle and you were showing how to make things glow. That was super cool. And it really demonstrated how when you've got a definite bright directional light, then you've got definite dark shadows on the lee side. Tinderful enchantments. Thank you. Thank you, May. Yeah. Carla Markova. Cool book. But anyway, so yeah, you know, that's one example. And then the ambient light is another example. You can pick and choose. I mean, it's a great thing about coloring books, coloring pages, is you can choose where you want your light source to come from. And you could change the mood, the whole mood of your picture by changing your light source. If I wanted to change my light source and make this really spooky, I would have it coming from the top. And that would make her eyes look super shaded. Because her eyebrows, or the eyebrow bone, would shade that a little bit more. And her head, if you look, her head is tilted down just a smidge. So she would have a darker spot over her eyes. And that would mean that this shadow from her eyelids would come like lower. And you can fix that with, you know, micron pens or whatever. And or darker colored pencils, and you can just put in your own. But the cool thing is, and then if you want to put it like it, this would have worked really well also if the light was coming from over here and shining from this way. You know, I mean, you just change where your shadow orientation is and you can change the mood. You want to make it look like it's morning, like the sun is coming up, then your light source might be coming from down here and shining up like that. And if you think about it, that might make her look like she's standing maybe on some raised ground and the sunrise is coming over the horizon at an elevation that's lower than she is. And then that you kind of add some pinks and coral undertones here and there. And you've got a whole different mood for your picture. It's amazing what you can do. And it's really, really not that difficult. But knowing which colors sometimes can be, It's just, but then too, again, it could depend on you. I mean, what does your sunrise look like? What does your sunset look like? What's your favorite color in your sunset? Capitalize on that. I just think art is so cool. So I'm going to go over this just a little bit more, and then I'm going to go on with my third color. My third color is going to be Nectar, which is 1092. And then my last color is going to be Deco Peach, which is 1013. And those are both Prismacolors as well. So if you are coloring this or something else that is similar, you can use those colors. You don't have to use those colors. Any artist will tell you that you can exchange something else for the colors that I've just mentioned, depending on how you want your person to look. What do you want her skin to look like? You know? Do you want her to have, I don't know, if she's cold, maybe she's got pinker color in her cheeks and nose, because that, the cold makes your nose and cheeks look pink. So, you know, I mean, of course she's not in the cold because she'd probably be shivering and shimmying her clothing right off her body. Still really light pressure, really light pressure. Yep. So totally love doing skin. Love it, love it, love it. I know I'm a weirdo. A little bit darker under there. And yes, that's another place that I'm going to go back and go do my final shade when I'm doing the darker shading to make it. Because when you're doing something like this, to make your lighters look light, you need to make your darks look dark. And if you think it's dark enough, sometimes it's not dark enough. How do I know where the light comes from? And I don't mean to sound rude, but I often answer, just pick a place where the light comes from, because that's what it is. Yes. Light source and go from there. That's right. Oh, that's true, May. You can, yeah. If you're excited, you can turn pink and, yeah. Or if you're embarrassed, and that's something that happens to me a lot because I have fair skin. I get embarrassed and boy, you talk about blush. Woo! It doesn't happen very often. Not much embarrasses me. But yeah, you know, you pick your light source, pick it. Unless you're in a studio and you've got an assignment, which is fun too. I mean, I remember being in college and having those assignments where you draw a ball on a table. And it's super fun. It's simple. And it's just a practice thing, but I loved it. I loved all of that stuff. I really, really enjoyed college. I went to college on grant money because I was a single mom with a part-time job. And I went to school and... Hey, Pat, that's a really good idea. Sometimes I do that too. I'll make like a little light X where my light source is, or an arrow. Or even, you know, one of those little stickery thingies with the arrow, like the lawyers put on paperwork when they say sign here where that arrow is, and it's a sticky note. Yeah. But yeah, when I went to college, I was a single mom with two kids, and I was, for a while anyway, and I was, you know, we lived in our little apartment, and oh my God, what a challenge. What a challenge. And I know that that's not unique to me. I had two boys, and I totally expected my oldest or my youngest to be in trouble all the time. And the remarkable thing was, is that my youngest was rarely ever in trouble. And my oldest got in trouble all the time. And I did not expect that. I was just like, who are you? He would do stuff like when he was 13 or 14. He went to a rated R movie with some older friends of his. And I found out about it. And I was like, you're grounded. You are in so much trouble. And, you know, usually for me to be upset about something back then, I would yell. But this time I was so hot under the collar. I was so mad. I was just like, you are grounded. And he looked at me like he thought the world was going to end. Anyway, yeah, he got in a lot of trouble for that. That was just one of the things, little stinker. My youngest, dang that dude, talk about smart. Oh, sheesh. Kid, all through high school, he was in band. And every time he picked up a new instrument, it took him, I kid you not, maybe a week to pick it up, a week to learn how to play the dang thing. And we're talking tuba, trumpet, saxophone. The boy was, it still is, just really, really smart. And he's, I don't know, is he 30 now? I think he's 30. I think he just turned 30. But yeah, man, he's awesome. And he's the sweetest thing. Him and his girl have been together, what, like 9 years, I think? And she can sing like an angel and play guitar, and she writes her own songs, and I'm so proud of both of them. Yeah. Both super talented. He can play anything you want. Any instrument he wants, he can play. He just doesn't because it's not what he wants to do. And I appreciate that about him, that he knows what he wants to do, or knows what he doesn't want to do. Almost ready for that third color. And we're almost ready. Oh boy, we've got about 20 minutes left. Sue, yeah, You know, it's really hard. When you're divorced, you've got all those mental issues about being divorced, and well, I did anyway. And then you start school, and it's actually, it was kind of, let's see, what is my next color? Nectar. Nectar is 1092 Prismacolor. And this is kind of a pink color. This is really beautiful. So we're going to go, actually, we're going to go, because faces are generally lighter in tone, generally, than the rest of the body. I don't know if anybody has really taken a good look. Most of the time, people's faces, especially their upper face, is lighter, because when you're out, you're usually shading your eyes, or you're wearing a hat that's shading your eyes, or you're standing in the shade so you can see, because if there's sun in your eyes, you can't see. So generally, this part of your face is going to be lighter. Sometimes this is darker, but not much. And then your neck is really light, especially right under your chin. You know how you see those ladies with the little reflector thing, and they're holding it like on their collarbones, and they're directing the light back up at their face? They're trying to even out their tan, because that part of their body, the neck and face, is naturally not as tan as the rest of them, because it is generally shaded. So something to think about. It's going to be more pink or more peachy, whatever the undertone is, it's going to be a little lighter, sometimes a lot lighter. Now with me, because I'm in Arizona. If I go out in the sun, it's like 10 minutes and I'm a lobster. I don't generally tan. I don't normally tan. I just turn red. So I don't really ever, and haven't really ever, gone out in the sun a lot. Now, when I lived in California, I did go out in the sun a lot, and I got burned badly several times. And because I got burned so many times in a row, one year I actually was super, super tan. And that was like only the second time. It was the first of two times in my life that I was tan enough to show, you know, look, I've got a tan. And my neck was still lighter. My neck and face were still lighter than the rest of my body. So when you're coloring with your colored pencils, you know, keep that in mind, where, you know, you want to kind of look at where would that sun not hit naturally. Where would that be that the sun is not going to hit naturally? Just going to go over this all really light, because there's still one more color, and that's my highlight color. So I think I'm going to darken this up a little bit though too, because I think it's still a little too light right around where that center part is. I think I darkness a little bit more into the arms and leg, because their other leg is mostly hidden. It's here, but it's kind of mostly hidden. So but anyway, yeah, you know, if you're me, my whole body is glow in the dark white. Because I don't go out in the sun. It's Arizona. It's hot. It's horrible. It's like, it can be lethal to be out there. They just rescued, saw on the news, they just rescued a whole group of hikers from, I can't remember, back east somewhere where it's cooler in the summertime, and they weren't prepared for how hot and dry it is here. And they went hiking, and there was like seven or eight people that had to be rescued, seriously, because they went out hiking and took enough water, and they all got heat stroke, and they weren't ready for that. And I don't know, man, what is it about 110 degrees in the shade that you do not understand, folks? Please be careful. Oh my God. And you hear these stories about people having it being hot enough to fry an egg on the sidewalk. It takes a little while, but yes, you can fry an egg on the sidewalk here in the middle of the summertime. And you can also bake cookies on the dash of your car if you put them on a cookie sheet. It takes a little longer than it would in an oven because your car only gets to like what? It's like 180, 200 degrees if it's a really super, super hot day and this is in the sun. So it's going to take a little bit longer for those cookies to actually get done, but they're semi-edible when they're, yeah, we're not kidding. It's bad. It's super hot here. And I know we're not the only place like that. Now, up in northern Arizona, don't let people tell you that there aren't beautiful, cool places up here in Arizona because, or down here in Arizona, because there are up in northern California. Or northern Arizona, around Cholo and the Mogollon Rim, Alpine, Prescott. There's really nice weather a lot of the time. Flagstaff, a lot of people have heard of Flagstaff because the college is there, the university. I think it's ASU. ASU or U of A? Anyway, one of the two. You could tell I didn't go there. So, yeah, the weather. NAU? What'd you say? Oh, well, he didn't hear me. Oh, okay. NAU. It's NAU. Anyway, so yeah, up north in Arizona, it's beautiful and cool. And when I lived in Cholo, I lived there for 9 years and it got above 90 degrees, maybe 1 week out of the year. So we didn't even have an AC. We just had a wood burning stove and that was it. So yay, Okay, so what do you guys think? How's she coming along? Got her skin tones coming along. She needs to be darker, though. She totally does. Oh yeah, Sue. Flagstaff is a great place. In fact, there's a place up there called Walnut Canyon that has Indian ruins and stuff in it, and it's like a straight down. The stairs go straight down the side of a canyon to the Indian ruins, and it is absolutely gorgeous. You can stand on the edge of the canyon. And the ravens soar and they're soaring on an updraft, but they're eye level to you. So it's so cool. I love that place, Walnut Canyon. Yeah, she needs to be a little darker. This nectar is a beautiful color. Oh my gosh, love it. May, you might be able to. It doesn't get too awfully hot in Flagstaff. Thank you, May. Thank you, Sue. Yeah, Flagstaff. Oh my God. Lots and lots. It's so beautiful. There's a lot of pine trees and a lot of juniper. There's a whole lot of pine trees. And man, oh, the smell. I love the smell of the pine trees. Woo! It's funny too, when I lived in Cholo for those 9 years, I got used to the smell of pine trees. It's just crazy because I could remember while I was up there, I could remember when we'd go up there just to visit or vacation or go through there to go somewhere else. And I could smell the pine trees from like miles away, and I'd just be breathing in that wonderful pine scent. And after I'd been up there for a little while, you couldn't, it's it, you weren't aware of the smell anymore. You build up the resistance to smell and you just get so used to it. But yeah, Flagstaff is really beautiful. Alpine is even more beautiful, I think, because Alpine is this tiny little city. It's a town actually. But it's not really a city because it's too small, but talk about thick wilderness and the elk. the huge elk herds love that place because there aren't a lot of people up there. So you'll when they start migrating and when mating season comes along, you'll see these huge herds just moving through the clearings, just making all their noise, and man, absolutely gorgeous. We had a, when I lived in Sholo, we had a, I lived on a little piece of land with my significant other. It was 4 acres, I think, attached to another 8 acres that was a relative's plot of land. And we didn't have any fences, really. We had a fence around the front, and then we had some, the relative had some fencing, like 4-foot fencing around the front yard. And one morning I woke up and I'm in the kitchen, and from the kitchen window, you can see there was like a hill that went down into this creek. And then on the other side of the creek, the hill went up, and then it turned into this small mountain. And I'm in there, and I'm getting stuff ready for breakfast, and I'm doing all this. And I looked out the window, and we had a 6-foot chain link fence around the backyard, but the backyard was maybe 50 feet by 40 or 30 feet. It wasn't really, really huge. And I looked out the window, and in our driveway was this adolescent elk in velvet. Its horns, its antlers still had velvet. And, oh, thank you, Pat. Oh, Slide Rock. Yeah, Slide Rock is pretty cool, but they keep having to shut it because there's so many people in the water. It makes the bacteria too high. And then it's not healthy to swim in it. It's really kind of sad. But anyway, so I look out the window, and there's this adolescent elk standing in the driveway. And he's where he's standing because of the angle of the driveway in the house. It was like 15 feet away from the window. So I'm like, oh my God. Oh my God. It's right there. So I go running back to the bedroom to wake up my SO. And I'm back there. And I didn't realize, because the house is built on bricks, so there's an airflow underneath. I went pounding through the house, and it echoed, and it scared the elk away while I was back in the bedroom trying to wake them up. I'm like, there's an elk right outside the kitchen window. Oh my God, you got to come and see it. So we both get up, we both go leave the room, run out back out to the kitchen, and it's gone. And I'm like, oh no, I know what happened, because I'm such a freaking dork. Yeah, I went clobbering through the house with my feet and scared the dang thing away. But anyway, I got to see it, which was nice. I had to get some water. So yeah, that was pretty incredible. You don't realize how big they are until they're that close to you. It's just, sorry, Sue. Are you the one that keeps telling Pat not to touch the thing with the picture with your hands? I've got this nice little nifty brush. It's super soft. You can tell I use it all the time. Ooh, and I wanted to tell you guys something else too. I wish Mary was here. This is a blender. It's a blender pen. Okay. Colored pencil blender pen. And the reason why I got this is because it was on Jerry's Artorama. It's got solvent in it. And you can tell I've used it already, but it's got solvent in it, and it blends your wax-based colored pencils. Isn't that neat? It's kind of stinky, but it works really, really well. Hi. For what? Oh my gosh, you guys. Okay, you know what? I'm having so much fun. I completely forgot to look at the clock. It's almost time for me to go. So Sunday, I'll have all that stuff ready. If you guys want it and you can't remember what to bring, I'll tell you right now. Oh, May, I know. Elk are wonderful. May, they do? I'm going to have to look for those. These weren't very expensive, though. They're the Jerry's brand, so they weren't very expensive. But I'm going to have to look for those because I trust that name brand, Derwent. Love their everything pretty much. So anyway, for Sunday, the acrylic painting, you will need one acrylic canvas board, 8x10 or larger, or a canvas paper, a pad, you know, like a paper, canvas paper from a pad, or anything to paint acrylic on. A small brush, a medium brush, and a large brush for acrylic paints. Don't use one that you've already used for oil paints because it's bad. The oil residue really never goes away, and it kind of can mess up your acrylics. So I don't know if you guys know that, but it's just not a good practice to get into. Then you will need acrylic colors in some kind of blue, hopefully a sky-worthy blue, black, gray, and white. Or if you don't have gray, you can always mix it with the black and white. And then you'll need some water and a palette. Like I was saying before, you can use palette. You can use an old colored pencil tin. You can use a paper plate. You can use a plastic anything, because you can just peel off the acrylic once it dries. You can peel it off because it turns into like this plastic sheet of paint stuff. So anyway, there's that. And of course your water. And I'll show you how I do the spooky trees, spooky Halloween trees. And I'll show kind of a example. I've got an example or three around here I can show you. So if you want 2 o'clock Pacific time on Sunday, and hopefully I'll see you guys there. If you haven't subscribed already, subscribe. I really, really, really appreciate it more than you know. It's really hard to get started on YouTube. And ring the bell to get notifications when I come out with some new content. I do intend to do some other tutorials. I have a couple in my mind about jewelry tutorials. And then there's the one on Sunday. And more color alongs like this. And, of course, the Victorian color along, color-a-thon, and the Spooktober. And a thank you mods or mod. Thank you so much. It'll be fun. Seriously, it's not one of those, it'll be fun, they said. It's more like a, it'll be fun, I swear. So, you know. And yes, I love Bruce Willis and the whole Die Hard series. I'm kind of a geek that way, too. Anywho's, you guys, thank you from the bottom of my heart. Love you all. Y'all are awesome. I will try and catch as many of your streams as I can. Hopefully. I gotta eat dinner, though. And then I thank you. I just don't even know what to say. Love you too, Nick and Tina. You're awesome. Okay, peace, love, polychrome dreams. And remember, it's not about the destination. It is about that art journey. See you later, guys. Thanks.